new places where people start here and then move across the chamber, that would be fantastic. Thank you.
Yeah, I'm Councillor Allan Brame from the Oxton on the Wirral. Councillor Steele.
Councillor Tom Cardwell from Stephen Garston.
Councillor John Prince from Newsley Ward in Liverpool.
And Councillor Bernie Marrat and Phil Ward in Liverpool.
Chris Rankin, I'm the Business Operations Team Leader for the Port Health Authority.
I'm Michael Douglas, I'm the Chief Port Health Officer or Head of the Port Health Service.
Leanne Sefton, I work with Democratic Services.
And Christine Mallard from the Sands Ward. Thanks everyone. First of all, can I advise members that apologies for absence have been received from Councillor Paul Hayes, Councillor Jason Walsh, Councillor Anna Byrne and Councillor Mike Morris. Are there any further apologies?
Yeah, Councillor Doreen Knight.
So, item number one, declarations of interest. Can I invite members and officers present to declare any pecuniary and or significant prejudicial interests in the business on the agenda? If the latter, you will need to leave the room when that item of business is considered. Thank you. Item number two, minutes of the last meeting. Can I refer members to the minutes of our agenda of our last meeting as held on the 14th July 2022, set out on pages 1 to 7 of the agenda. Do any members have any questions or comments? No? Can I move that the minutes be approved? Is that agreed?
Agreed.
Item number 3, quarterly report, January to March 2022. Can I refer members to pages 8 to 14 of the agenda pack, which comprises the quarterly report for the period the 1st of January to the 31st of March 2022. And can I invite Nicole Douglas, Chief Port Health Officer, to introduce the report.
Thank you, Chair. Good morning, Chair. Good morning, members and relevant officers. So the purpose of this report, quarterly report, is quite a short quarterly report, but very significant because of the work that occurred during that period. It's comprised members of the current enforcement work and the projects and training and promotional work was undertaken by the authority during the period from the 1st of April to the 30th of June. So members will note that in section 2.1 we have some information on income generation from the service, and in the quarterly period you will notice that there has been a slight increase in the revenue generation during that period, which was, you know, was quite an interesting increase given that the service was moving out of obviously COVID pandemic, which you would naturally think would affect the number of imports that was the revenue of the service, but we have had a slight increase. In terms of imported food checks, table 2.2 details a number of consignments and the adding of full checks, and also again, I bring those to the attention that we have had an increase in the full checks during that period of quarter one. The reason for that was that the service during the latter part of the quarter one period was starting to remove the easement adaptations that was afforded by the UK government in order to undertake imported food checks and enable swift clearance of consignments through the port. As a result, we reduced a large number of percentage of physical checks that we needed on consignments, but we started to reinstate them towards the end of that period. So in correlation to that, there has been an increase in the number of full checks that were undertaken during that period. During the quarter one period as well, the authority still continued to undertake IUU, which is a legal, reported and unregulated documentation checks. Since the UK has exited the EU, there is now a requirement for the service to also undertake checks on European catch certificates. And so the authority still continues to do that, and members will see that during that period, the authority undertook 183 rest of the world checks in that particular area, as well as 42 on European consignments. In relation to the samples undertaken by the service during that period, the authority undertook a number of samples, and members will see that further details of the specifics of those failures and the products that failed are detailed in Annex 1 to the report. In relation to rejected consignments, during that period the authority rejected 4 foods of non-animal origin consignments, and there was 9 products of animal origin consignments subject to rejection, and details of those are also available in the report. In relation to the number of consignments that referred inland, the authority referred 1 consignment through to an inland authority. For members that are not aware, when a consignment is referred inland, we will carry out surveillance checks at the port, and then we have to release that consignment pending the results. If we receive results that are either irregular or unsatisfactory, then we will notify the relevant local inland authority for them to take further action, which usually means that they will take control of that consignment and then take any necessary action to remove it from the UK market. In relation to border readiness preparations, I've advised members there that it's quite a significant period for the service. Members will be aware that for a significant period of time now, the service has been carrying out border preparedness checks because of the UK's exit from the EU. Central government advised the service that the authority would need to prepare for an increase of consignments that would be travelling through the port and subject to new sanitary checks at the port. A number of years ago, we were provided with a figure from central government, and so it was necessary for the service to strategise and prepare for that potential work increase. We've had regular communications with central government on these particular figures that have been provided, and in preparation for that as well, funding was made available by central government for the service to increase the staff resources in association with potential predicted workload. There's been a lot of decisions that have been pending in order to refine the particular staffing resources, and as a result, both myself and Chris, who sat beside me, designed a staffing resource plan as well as a strategy plan to prepare for the potential work increase. Funding has been received over a period of time from central government to enable us to increase our staffing resources, and members will note from the AGM report that we did increase our staffing resources by an additional 18 members of staff. During the quarter one period, the government advised all UK ports that the target operating model that was subject to review and design, and that will also determine the type of checks that are required by the port health authorities, was due for introduction on the 1st of July. As we approached that period, the port health authorities and the relevant local authorities were then advised that actually a decision has been made at the UK level to not introduce the actual type operating model, and in turn the actual official checks will not be introduced on the 1st of July. Instead, a UK government decision was made to revise the entire target operating model. In light of that, what they also advised the authorities was that, unfortunately, to protect the public purse, that they could no longer sustain the relevant staff resources that had been recruited in preparation to undertake these checks, and so all government funding would also cease. Now, from a service point of view, that was the worst case scenario that could occur to the service. We obviously recruited a significant number of staff, while not the number required, or at least the number that was suggested based on the figures by central government, we have still increased the number of staff significantly. At the same time, we've invested a lot of time in training the staff. A number of strategies were put in place to try to mitigate the financial risk to the service, but nonetheless, the crucial risk to the service was any cessation of government funding. And so, from our point of view, it
and advised the chair and the deputy chair of that decision as and when it occurred, because it was fundamentally a big knock to the service, which then meant that once again we needed to strategise on how we need to mitigate and what we need to do, because while the UK government has delayed the introduction of the target operating model and therefore delayed the introduction of the checks, at the same time they cannot give a determination on when the checks will be introduced and what the checks will look like. So there is definitely a potential that as and when that date is determined, which was suggested autumn this year, that has once again been delayed because of all the current situation with the UK, we may need some of the staff. It's not very clear cut, you know, to lose the staff could put us in a risky situation and create a risk to the service, but at the same time, to sustain the staff also increases the financial risk to the service. So in response to that, it was necessary to create a strategy again, which would generate potential revenue and also create cost savings to the service. And so that has been designed by myself and Chris, and we are currently in the process of implementing some of those strategies. Once again, just to advise members that within the report, I have advised that in preparation of the new target operating model, it's still necessary that we continue to undertake projects. It's also still necessary that we continue to implement strategic initiatives and keep adapting to the decisions as and when they are clarified to the service. Fundamentally, the service needs to be prepared for the introduction of the new checks, but at the same time, it's trying to sustain the staff and resources to an effective level to enable us to be available and ready for when those checks are introduced. The last meeting that I attended, it has been proposed that the checks will be clarified and potentially introduced, or at least the target operating model released, at the beginning of 2023. And so we keep engaging with central government and we keep preparing for that eventuality, and I will obviously keep updating members on that process. In relation to just to advise members that there was a comment from one of the members previously just about staffing structure. So I have just clarified within the report there the current staffing structure moving forward for the 2022-23 financial period, and members will see that. I've also noticed that actually the staffing structure has removed one of the initial tables in relation to international health regulations. And so just to advise members that the service still continues to fulfil 100% of ship sanitation requests to the service, as well as issuing 27 ship sanitation exemption certificates during the quarter one period, undertaking 11 of those, which are ship sanitation lights, and they've since been removed because we are reinstating the service back to business as usual, as well as undertaking water sample visits, and officers undertook 39 during that period. The Port Health Service processed and actioned 1,562 ship arrival informations. So the service is still busy on the international health regulation control area. We are still receiving cases of COVID through the port naturally, because that has not gone away. And I just advise members that obviously the UK government did publish its relevant living with COVID-19 in relation to the pandemic. But we are still dealing with the cases through the port and carrying out any necessary action in accordance with UK HSA in relation to those cases. Officers still continue to make an assessment of all vessels that arrive through the port of Liverpool and provide health protection information when needed. In regards to vector surveillance in accordance with International Health Regulation Annex 5, we continue to carry out monitoring, which is a project that we have been undertaking for a period of years with Public Health England, as well as Edgehill University. Officers are currently placing traps at the Port of Liverpool, as well as Liverpool General and Airport. To date, when I reported on this report, we haven't had any positive identification or at least captured any suspect mosquitoes with that project. We still continue to make representation at various meetings, quite a significant number of meetings during that period, and that 80 external meetings were attended by Port Health representatives, a large percentage of them being related to the Board of Registrable.
issues are identified in section 3.1. The service needs to focus on strategy formation to achieve border control readiness and continuously adapt to the UK decisions that are made at that time. We need to implement the authority's revenue generation and saving strategies to mitigate financial risk as a result of those decisions, as well as continuing to explore methods of securing financial support from central government. We need to also assist with the designation of the border control post, because obviously that is one of the things as well that is a necessity of the outcome of the UK's exit from the EU. And so we are continuously working with central government as well as the port operator to achieve that status. And then we also need to continue to engage with central government and continue to represent meetings. That continues my very brief call to the port members. Thank you. Certainly, because I kind of liken it to a goalpost that just keeps moving out and out. Every time we feel that we are achieving an end goal, we're then advised, actually, this is now going to happen. At the same time, it's also quite difficult because, yes, all the staff that was recruited as a financial risk mitigation strategy were recruited on a fixed term contract. The lower grade members of staff, which, grade threes and fours, they were actually recruited on a 6 month contract, and the more senior grade sevens were recruited on a 12 month. But we've been dealing with this for the best part of 2.5-3 years. So the extra workload of justifying having to continuously extend those contracts brings extra workload as well and extra anxiety to the team that feel that their contracts are constantly being extended and it doesn't really give them job security. So that brings a bit of the challenges. In terms of the finance, both myself and Chris work on the finances every week. Chris is fantastic with figures and he's designed a tracker so we can track the spend of the government finances that we've received. At the same time, the revenue and strategy plan is to secure extra government funding where possible. While the UK government did advise that they were unable to continue funding for the additional staffing resources after July, they did offer out potential secondment opportunities with other enforcement agencies and also introduce a safeguard measure project in partnership with Border Force. So we are trying to reach out and try to obtain those opportunities as much as possible to obtain the revenue generation. We are undertaking the partnership project with Border Force at the moment, which will fund a number of staffing resources for the service. That project commenced on the 1st of September with the introduction of a new safeguard measure relating to African swine flu. And so we are participating in that project, and as a result,
I am able to recuperate the staff and resources that are involved with that particular partnership. In addition to that, we also have applied for funding from the Food Standards Agency to also undertake border readiness checks from their aspect. Obviously, the Food Standards Agency are a central competent authority for the foods of non-animal origin aspect of the work that we do. And so I once again have applied for funding with them. We've actually been successful with that. I received a notification yesterday. And obviously, I've advised members of the specifics of those details at the relevant reporting period. In terms of the strategies of the service, yes, it is vital that the staff and resources that I have, I've got work for them. And so with the staff and resources, we have trained them in all areas of poor health. I have repurposed a number of the resources. The Port Health Service has always been a very busy service, and I've always had to balance out the responsive work, the reactive priority work, to the proactive work. And we then had COVID, which then once again increased the service demand. And so actually, a scoping exercise that Chris and I have done in terms of streamlining the work and assessing the work demands of the service, I'm able to allocate positions to each of those. And so with the revenue and savings strategies, we've been able to streamline work resources to workloads that we need to do for service that we've needed to do for a long period of time. And so there are a number of projects that we are undertaking at the moment with the service. We need to catch up on a lot of the service that was delayed because of COVID. COVID meant that we suspended a lot of our statutory functions, and we're able to reinstate them. So those staff and resources are also being utilised for that. The preparedness work hasn't stopped. While the government are still pending their decision, I still need to prepare the service, and there's local data that we need to capture, the scoping exercises that we need to undertake. We need to know what's coming through our port because we don't have that data from anyone. And so those staff and resources as well are also capturing those particular types of information that will enable me to make a more refined strategic decision on the staff and resources moving forward. In addition to that, the actual cost savings, increasing the number of inspections that we do. We carry out export checks, but it isn't a priority for the service. It's not mandatory, but we can charge for those checks, and so we've expanded that service. We've developed that service more, and we will be offering that out because we have been asked by a number of our importers whether we can undertake those checks, so we are expanding that particular area. In addition to that, we are also participating in a UK sampling surveillance project with the Food Standards Agency, and we can cross charge for that particular service. In terms of cost saving, we have secure facilities at the Port of Liverpool. At the moment, members are aware that we occupy Victoria House, but then with occupation, we do pay an annual rental fee and an associated cost to that. I would like to reduce our occupancy of Victoria House, which will once again make a cost saving. I'm trying to think, is there anything else, Chris, that we've also done? We've done quite a meticulous, yeah. Training. We have been one of the key training ports. I had to cease the training that we offered because priority, COVID, border readiness. We're in the process of redesigning our training programme. Previously, we used to charge to deliver that training to students, to officers of other ports. Once again, the intention is to reinstate that. So I do have a number of strategies that I will be implementing to secure the financial resources and at least secure the staff resources that are needed for the service. At the moment, Chris and I are also compiling data for the workload so that in January, I feel like that will be the crucial month that I will be able to have the data that's been collated by the services that we need to provide, and I will correlate that for staff resources and in comparison refine the staff resources where needed. At the same time, I'm hopeful that the UK government will have released the target operating model then, and we will know what the workload demand is from the target operating model for the checks. So January is the crucial one.
So, my some of my questions are very similar to yours. I would agree, you know, God. Very brave, you know. It's incredible the route that we've chosen to go down as a nation, isolationism, nationalism, trade barriers, etc. I guess I've got two sets of questions, or in one case, I'm probably asking you to point me in the right direction. Firstly, a building on what you said about, you know, the training, the time, the effort, etc. I remember, I think, the first Port Authority, Port Health meeting that I sat on, we talked about how difficult it was to get people and how difficult it was to get recruiting. I'm just wondering, are we talking about potential to lose people here? Are we talking about people who may be relocated here? You know, extend to themselves and to yourselves, you know, and what kind of impact is that having upon morale, etc., in the team? And then the other one I come on to is in 2.4, the rejected consignments, and here I'm asking probably for you to point me in the right direction. The UK's food availability is plummeting. We're the only one in the developed world whose food availability is plummeting to the extent that it is. You know, most countries that you're talking about 2-3% down to, we've gone from 90% to 70% and we're still falling. I represent a part of the city which is not in the top 1% of deprivation in the UK, but in the top 1% of deprivation in Europe. We have malnutrition, we have rickets, and things like this emerging. Food inflation, real food inflation, whether you read the Guardian or you look at IGP figures or whatever, is going to be well in excess because of the compound rate way in excess of 100% again. So we're talking about food doubling in price. So for people in wards like mine, that has a massive impact. So I guess what I'm saying is, when we have all these rejected consignments, we're talking about quite a bit of food here, I would imagine. Where would I find volume and value? Do we even have that? Is that, would that be called by the organisation or whatever? Because obviously the food industry is saying, you know, all of these are additional costs, and that then relates to, you know, food inflation, that impact on food inflation and food availability, as well as things like our balance of payments as a nation, which is worse than it was during World War II. I think every country performed worse than some men with Russia, you know, so we've imposed sanctions on ourselves. I know that's a decision the nation's taking, not you, but it's understanding the impact and how it impacts the poorest, because people in this chamber and the chambers in Sefton and Borough are doing great stuff to, you know, food banks and helping people, but the root cause of this is not being addressed. So I would like to get that data, and it's not for here, I don't expect you to have it, but can you tell me how I would get the volume and value, you know, of that food that's been destroyed, and what the trend is year on year? Thank you.
Thank you. So in regards to your question in terms of training, yes, a large amount of time is invested in training staff. It's continuous competence levels, and you know, as you alluded to, the recruitment that we had, we, for financial risk mitigation again, we recruited more, a large percentage of the lower scaled graded staff, so they needed more significant supplementary training than the levels of the grade sevens that we produced. Yes, investing is having an impact on around the team. We do keep regular communications and engagement with the team. I think it's necessary that they are engaged, it's necessary that they are aware, and they are, you know, we're completely transparent with decisions that are made and how that is going to have an impact on them. And we also had an away day so that they fully understand what the implications are for the UK's government's decisions, how those impact on the team, and why those decisions need to be made, which I think with full understanding, that helps mitigate any anxieties that can occur. We do have an open door policy within the team where I make myself available, and so do the team leaders, 24 hours a day for any concerns that staff have. They all have personal numbers that they're able to communicate with us. For me, while I will like to say that I am trying my absolute utmost to mitigate loss of staff because we have invested so much in them, but it's unsure as to whether we need them, I believe that all the strategies that we're putting in place, all the monitoring, the continuous daily, if not weekly monitoring that we're doing to make sure that we are assessing the workload, demand, what is the exact number of people that we need in the service, what's the exact skill set that we need and the staff that we need to retain,
I would like to mitigate. I believe that the soft approach of the implementation of the staff and resource strategy that was initially implemented by me, in that we didn't go straight away and recruit 100% of staff. We took it in stages. We only got to stage two, which meant the additional staff and resources was only at 40% needed for the initial plan. And so I believe by having that approach, we're not doing mass redundancies, which is what we initially would have if we'd have just gone 100% with a recruitment plan. If we do need to lose staff, I'd like to keep it at its most minimal. The service is increasing despite everything that's going on. Surprisingly, we track the service on a weekly basis, and there has been a percentage increase. I think it's about 18% increase the last time I checked the figures. So imported food is increasing through the port. However, my reporting changes, we've had other things that's going to impact imports. Obviously, strike action at the Port of Liverpool undoubtedly is impacted on the imports coming through the port, which then undoubtedly will impact on the revenue that's generated from those official checks. So at the moment, we are continuously hit with challenges, and it's necessary for us to adapt. In adapting to that, staff are all located at the port when the strike is released to try and do all the clearances as quickly as possible. So from my point of view, in terms of staff and resources, I'm putting every available strategy in place to try to mitigate that, but ultimately it rests with this determination of what the workload will be in relation to the target operating model. I can tell you that we've had some resignations received, which is expected. All those will be taken into account when, once again, Chris and I are working on the budget this afternoon to review and see what it looks like for the month moving forward. And then again, what impact happens after that. And I will definitely produce a report to tell you when those decisions are made. In relation to the rejected products, I can tell you that a lot of the products that are rejected at the Port of Liverpool, yes, they're subject to charges when we do a non-compliance check, but our charges are very competitive. Central government have harmonised charges. When we implement any other charges that are determined from a local level, we will make sure that they are very consistently competitive with other UK ports. So we are not the highest in the UK. In relation to a rejected consignment, because a lot of the goods are shelf stable, a majority of the time the importer will re-export those products, rectify what the non-compliant aspect is, and then they will, a majority of the time, re-import. If the products are rejected, they would have to go for destruction, and the destruction would be to ensure that it's removed from the UK market in its entirety, so it's an incineration under controlled measures. We don't have many rejections, and it's most certainly not from a product of animal origin aspect. And as I said, the other aspects we usually get re-exported. In terms of the cost value for that, I would probably be suggesting that maybe it's central government that could provide that, because they would be able to provide you, yeah, DEFRA will be able to provide you with the overall figures for the UK as a whole. So I would recommend that you contact DEFRA. I'm more than happy to give you the contact details. So yeah, they'll be able to provide absolutely everything, the weights, and then you'll be able to accommodate. Thank you. Any more questions?
Thank you, Chair. And thank you, Nicole, for a very comprehensive report. Thank you. I just want to ask one question. Obviously, it's in the news at the moment. Peel Port and the amount of cargo that's coming in is a lot less, they're saying, due to rising interest rates, higher energy costs, and weakening consumer demand for manufactured and imported goods. What effect is that having on yourselves at the Merseyside Port Authority?
So the last data figures that I received from my business operations team, we have had a reduction in imports. While overall over the quarter we've had an increase in imported food, but I've been asking them to map also the impact, obviously, of the strike operations at the Port of Liverpool, and so we've had In terms of the reduction of imports through penal ports, only time will tell. I probably need more quantifiable figures over a period of time to see if there has been a dip. And that will be also taken into consideration the recent figures of the strike action. We only need to know about imported food. While penal ports will be reporting on absolutely everything that comes through the port, the steel, the wood, everything helps. Mine would be more specific to imported food, and we would have to assess our own internal figures. So I would be suggesting I don't do maybe a 6 month map of that, maybe 12 months, 6 months data before we can make a full determination. Because at the same time, things are seasonal through the port. So if I was only to maybe do it over a 3 month period, I wouldn't say that that would be a true reflection because we may get a spike the following month. So I'm happy to report that after 12 months. Thank you. Any other questions? No? Just a couple from myself, Dan Cole. So first of all, you mentioned the data collection exercise that's happening at the moment to map that against your resource profile and entire operating models implemented and all that kind of thing. I was wondering if there are any early indications of what that's suggesting and how that stacks up against any assumptions that were made over the past 2.5 years. And then secondly, and it's not to do with the quarter that the report is in reference to, so I'll leave it up to you if it should be answered in this particular meeting, but obviously a lot of the decisions that have been made until recently about port and port health were from Mark has Brexit Opportunities Minister so called. Obviously, there's been a change in government. Rees-Mogg's moved into more of a straight up and down business role now. So I was wondering if there are any initial indications from the current government whether things are still on track or whether they're set to change. Thank you. Thank you. So in relation to the previous target operating model, and most certainly the one that they're proposing that they currently delayed, so the initial target operating model, the work that we do is obviously is risk-based approach, and so there are mandatory checks that we need to do, which are documentation checks, and then currently at the moment it's a percentage of identity and physical checks. With the other target operating model, they wanted to move into a more risk-based approach, which would look at the type of product, and then that would determine the checks. Because they revised it, the new proposal would be that there'd be a lot less the checks on products that they don't deem as high risk. So until they can clarify the actual framework of the checks, it's quite hard for us to even look at a particular category of products coming in and then say, right, we suspect these checks are going to be done, because there's various different variations of what could happen for those particular products, and that's the difficulties that we have with creating a strategy. In association with the type of checks that we undertake, there's an attachment of revenue. So with a doc check, we will have a bracket of charge for a doc check. If it's a physical, we charge more. So once again, it's then hard to correlate the revenue from potential checks. So until the UK government determine the target operating model, define what the checks are going to be, it's hard for us to correlate the finances from what would occur. What we're doing from our point of view, from the scoping exercise, is to try to explore and get a more refined indication of the products that are arriving through the port. At the moment, because checks are only undertaken on rest of the world products, there was never a need for European products to be notified to Port Health, and so we need to understand what's coming through the port from a European point of view, what do those products look like, and then from that, as soon as we get the refinement of the target operating model and the checks, we can then cross-match and say, if a percentage of these are subject to doc checks, this is the revenue that would come out of this. And Chris has actually already designed a formula to do that. So we'll be able to just enter that data and then generate what we expect annual revenue generation from those checks we apply, but it does rely on the definitive determination of these are the checks that you are going to undertake. Initial meetings are looking like they are reducing the checks in its entirety, so it won't be as onerous as the checks that we undertake on the rest of the world. At the same time, the proposal is that the rest of the world will align with this new process. So the risk for us is that, once again, it's going to impact the actual revenue that's generated from the rest of the world that we currently apply. So we really just need this determination of this specifics of the checks and target operator model, and then it will be for myself and Chris to straight away start gathering that information from the data that we've gathered locally as well. One of the other projects that we're proposing is that while we cannot legally impede the flow of European consignments through the port, that we could potentially start refining products and then selecting for potential sampling, but we've got to be really careful on how we do that, and we've really got to make sure that we're able to do that. So we are also at the moment trying to confirm that and agree, is that a potential for us? Because in the absence of having those legal powers to do that, we don't want to be hindering the European trade through the port. So it's just a constant block. It's not as straightforward as we would hope it would be. Yes, they were. What Chris and I have actually done, we've mapped worst case scenarios within this database. So we basically said, if there's been a drop of 50% of revenue, what would our resources need to be and how does this look? If there's a 25% drop, what do we need? At the same time, we've also been able to compile a figure on some of our various different estimations. We've actually compared different ideas to different formulas and able to say, what is the amount of revenue we need for this particular structure? And we have to keep amending it and adapting and change. So at the moment, rather than having one or two options, we've just got a list of options in Chris and I trying to guesstimate what could these outcomes be.
Any other questions from members? No? I move that we note the report. Is that agreed? Item number four is the schedule of dates. Can I remind members that our meetings will take place on Thursday the 12th of January 2023 at 11 a.m. in Liverpool and Thursday the 10th of March 2023 also at 11 a.m. in Liverpool. That concludes our business for this morning. Thank you very much, members.